English speaker series. Today we are pleased to present writer, director, filmmaker, and experimental maverick, Young Jean Lee. Yeah. I want to thank our partners for their support of today's program, the University Musical Society, or lovingly known as UMS, and Michigan Radio 91.7 FM. UMS, our nationally honored jewel just this year by President Obama, got the National Medal for the Arts recently, is now in its 137th season. And it is UMS who brings Young Jean Lee to town to present two of her plays over the next few days, opening this evening with the Untitled Feminist Show just up the road at the Power Center. This will continue tomorrow along with her second show opening, Straight White Men, at the Lydia Mendelson Theater. There are still tickets available. If you don't have yours yet, you can get them for this evening's show at the Power Center box office directly after the talk, or you can go to ums.org. And for all of you students in the audience, that's all of you students, not just U of M, just know you do always get reduced ticket prices for students, which are quite a deal. So do come to the shows. It seems that this week events are converging in Ann Arbor around gender and identity politics, certainly with Young Jean Lee's work, and I wanted to bring to your attention two relevant exhibition openings which also play into all of this. Many of you will recall last season in the Penny Stamps, we had First Nations artist Kent Monkman who spoke. Yeah, he was pretty fantastic, I thought. Anyway, he is back in town this evening, and his newest work, which has been commissioned by the Institute for Humanities, will be opening directly following the talk today on the way to see Young Jean Lee's show. You can stop at the Institute for Humanities and see his new installation, Scent of a Beaver, which is based on the Rococo masterpiece of The Swing by Fragonard. And it features Monkman's alter ego, which anyone who saw him speak last year, we all came to love, Miss Chief Eagle Testicle. Miss Chief Eagle Testicle will be dangling on a swing, so I wouldn't miss it. That's directly following the talk here. There's an opening reception at the Institute for Humanities. It's just around the corner from here on Washington. And Thayer, I did leave a few leaflets in the lobby, so maybe some of you picked them up. Then next Tuesday in Lane Hall, the Institute for Research on Women and Gender will host an exhibition above ground, 40 Moments of Transformation. This is a photography exhibition highlighting the powerful, groundbreaking performance art actions of China's young feminist activists known as the YFAs. This will include a talk by the exhibit curator Lu Ping, a Chinese feminist organizer. This will be Tuesday, 4 o'clock at Lane Hall, and the opening reception of the exhibition follows. And I learned an interesting tidbit about Lane Hall that I thought worthy of pointing out. They have a gender-neutral restroom on the first floor. So please remember to turn off your cell phones. We will have no Q&A today as for time constraints, so everyone can make it to the opening of the shows. So as evidenced by the furniture you see on stage today, our format will be a conversational interview. To introduce the characters you'll see before they take the stage, to lead the conversation today, we have Patricia Ibarra, director, dramaturg, and critic whose focus is theater historiography of the Americas, exploring the relationship between theater, nationalism, and American identities. She's the author of Performing Conquest, 5 Centuries of Theater, History, and Identity in Tlaxcala, Mexico, and co-editor of Theater and Neoliberalism Performance. She's the former administrator of Richard Foreman's Ontological Hysteric Theater and is currently teaching at Brown University. She is a longtime fan of Miss Lee's work. She is the author of Young Jean Lee's Cruel Dramaturgy, an essay about straight white men based on the 2013 Brown University workshop of the play. So, must be the right person for the interview. And then our guest of honor today, Young Jean Lee, is a writer, director, and filmmaker. She's been called the most adventurous downtown playwright of her generation by the New York Times, and one of the best experimental playwrights in America by Time Out New York. She's written and directed 10 shows in New York with Young Jean Lee's Theater Company, and toured her work to over 30 cities around the world. Her plays have been published by Theater Communications Group and by Samuel French. She's currently under commission from Lincoln Center Theater and the Oregon Shakespeare Festival, and has written a screenplay for Plan B Paramount Pictures. Her first short film, Here Come the Girls, was presented at the Locarno International Film Festival, the Sundance Film Festival, and BAM Cinema Fest. In 2013, she released her debut album, We're Gonna Die, with her band Future Wife. Ms. Lee is the recipient of a Guggenheim Fellowship, 2 OBIE Awards, a prize in literature from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, a Doris Duke Performing Artist Award, and the ZKB Patronage Prize of the Zürcher Theater Spektakel. When young Jean Lee begins working on a show, she asks herself, what's the last show in the world I would ever want to make? And then she forces herself to make that show. She's obsessed with unsettling complacency both in herself and in her audiences because she believes that contradiction and uncertainty bring us closer to the truth. Please welcome young Jean Lee and Patricia Ibarra.
So good evening, and thank you all for being here. It's really an honor to be able to have a conversation with young Jean Lee today as a longtime fan. And if you don't mind, I don't know if you want to start to say anything, or should I just start? Great. So I actually just want to pick up with the last statement that was made about making the piece of work that you would never want to make and sort of forcing yourself to do that. And so I think what's interesting about that is in the theater, we often want to make our audience feel welcome, and I think that that's interesting. But we also sometimes want to push our audience a little bit. But the way you talk about this is interesting because you don't talk so much about making your audience uncomfortable, but making yourself uncomfortable in the process. So I would love to hear you elaborate a little bit on that.
I think that, what was the most formative for me was, I spent the first 18 years of my life in this really small town in eastern Washington state where, it's like I was like one of the only Asian kids, and while I wasn't bullied, like nobody wanted to hang out with me. You know, it was just like, there was this sort of belief that, Asian people are weird, and we should just not have anything to do with them. And so, for the first 18 years of my life, I really experienced, total social isolation. And and I felt that growing up in that kind of environment where people just, they just felt, like we have these beliefs and, that's the way things should be. Like, there was something about that that was, pretty horrible. And then I went to Berkeley, and, Berkeley is obviously, there's lots of Asian people there, in case you didn't know, but, and lots of, every kind of person there, and it's sort of the opposite of the place where I grew up. And so I went there, and I just, like, embraced everything, and at a certain point, I remember I was raised very evangelical Christian, and, I had sort of rejected that when I was pretty young, and, when I went to Berkeley, I just met all of these people who hated Christians, and so I just, became this, like, oh my God, like, they're so, Christians, and, and at a certain point, I realized that I was exhibiting the exact same sort of behavior that the people I grew up with exhibited. It's that same mentality of just having zero empathy for or interest in a group of people who you happen to disagree with or have a bad impression of, And so, that was something that really stayed with me. Like, I don't want to be like that. I don't want to ever be, in a position and, like ISIS, I've been thinking about ISIS lately and, how horrible what they do, right? But then I was thinking, what if I was born into the circumstances of one of those suicide bombers? You know, like, given my personality, I would probably be, like, one of the most, you know, energetic suicide bomber, you know, planners and exit, you know, so it's like, you know, you can't, I don't know, I don't think you can just, I don't know, I guess I believe in, you know, while not sanctioning other people's horrible behavior, I think it's just very dangerous to have this idea of, you know, I'm this type of person and those people are this other more subhuman type of person. And so, you know, so one of the shows that I made, it was early in my career, was called Church. And it was an evangelical Christian church service that was basically designed to break down all of my smugness about what an awesome atheist I was, you know, and how great my life was, you know, and it's just, you know, there's, and what I found in making that show is there's a lot of things that Christianity provides to people that puts them in a way better position in many ways than I, you know, like, that there are, like, healthy aspects to that that I'm, like, missing in my life, and so, you know, I made this whole show, and I feel like that was a very transformative experience for me, and I've sort of tried to do that with every show, you know, just sort of go into some area where I have preconceived notions and force myself to sort of blow it all apart.
I don't know if you know this, but there was like a roving band of ex-evangelicals who used to follow Church. I don't know if you know this, but they all, it was
my,
like,
show, Church?
Mm-hmm. It's, oh, amazing. Yeah, it's an amazing show, but it's even more amazing for ex-evangelicals. Just, oh. I don't know if you know that. So it's really cool. I want to, what might be really helpful, because I know some people in the audience know Young Jean's work and some people might know it less. So what might be helpful actually is we do have a clip from a show, I think from 2000, is that right?
2006.
Which is Songs of Dragon Flying to Heaven. And I think, interestingly, I'm really glad you talked about the evangelical piece because it might help as a nice frame to see this moment. So enjoy.
Can I give them a little bit of context?
Yes,
okay, so this was a play I wrote pretty early in my career, and it was written because, you know, when I was just starting to be a playwright, you know, all these people were coming to me and saying, you know, like, you know, what do you want to do a show about? And I would tell them my idea, and they would be like, oh, like, what about an Asian American family drama where the kid plays the violin and they don't want to play the violin, and they're like, Dad, you don't understand me, like, we have an intergenerational conflict, you know, and everybody wanted me. Everybody wanted me to write that play, and I was starting to get really angry, and then I realized, like, oh no, like, that means I have to write that play, you know, so I came up with the most sort of flowery Asian title I could think. That always drove me crazy, that any Asian person's title has to be this sort of flowery, you know, sounding thing. So Songs of the Dragons Flying to Heaven was,
But there's a colon, right? Is it a colon?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, but the blurb we came up with was a play about white people in love, and you know, and it's awful because, like, you know, when people say, oh, she's the author of Songs of the Dragons Flying to Heaven, people just assume, you know, but so I made that play, and, you know, when I'm making a play that I don't want to make, I tend to go a little crazy, and you know, so as I was writing this play, all of a sudden this white couple showed up, and they just started having a relationship drama in the middle of my Asian American play. And then it became this thing where it's like, you know, the Asian people would shove them off and then, like, they would come back in and take over and have their relationship drama. And so that was the structure of the play. And this is a moment when the Asian people are taking over.
Great, so if we could show the clip, thank you.
This is the thing about climate control. Climate control is very important.
Why won't you have sex with me?
What do you mean?
You never want to have sex with me anymore. It makes me hate you.
It makes me hate you too.
Well, what's your problem? Why don't you want to have sex?
reason is because you gross me out, and I don't know why. It's just, you gross me out. You have all these things going for you, you really do. Things I would like to have myself, but you're just, I don't want to fuck you.
Those pens and jam them into the end of your penis.
I'll try to stop doing that, I promise.
So that still makes me laugh every single time. So I'm wondering if you could talk about creating this piece, but something you've said in other interviews is that people don't ask about your collaborators enough. And I know you have a really elaborate process of collaboration, but also of revising. So for example, with Straight White Men, the show that's coming here, I saw a very early version of it. And you told me, like, it's almost all gone. And then I looked at it and I was like, oh, it is almost all gone. You completely changed it. So I'd love to hear about those processes.
Okay, for Straight White Men, I was interested in the topic because I felt like we were in this sort of unique historical moment where all of a sudden, straight white men have an ethnic identity and a label and a bunch of stereotypes that go along with it. You know, for many years, they were just the default human, and it was just everybody else who had to deal with this stuff. And now suddenly, straight white men have people pointing at them and saying, like, you're such a straight white man, you know? And they hate it, obviously, because everybody hates it, you know? So they're sort of experiencing this for the first time, and I thought it would be really interesting to actually, that's not true. I didn't think it would be really interesting, but that's why I had to, you know, force myself to do it. And the point of the play for me was to, you know, take very seriously the idea of straight white maleness as an ethnic identity and find out everything that I could about it. And So the show really just started with me starting to have conversations with, you know, I ended up talking to, I think, like hundreds of straight white men and just interviewing them and asking them questions and learning all of this stuff that I had never known. And also I was an only child, and I knew that, you know, this is a play about three brothers, and so I had to, like, ask a lot of questions about what siblings were like around each other. I found the stories very hard to believe, and when we were implementing them in the show, I was like, there's no way men in their 40s would act like this. And people were like, trust me, they do. And now I've got, like, 80-year-old men coming up to me after the show saying, oh my God, my brothers and I still act that way around each other. And I find this really hard to believe. But I found at a certain point that, I wanted to bring, you know, because I work very collaboratively with my cast, and, my cast of straight white men, they really hadn't spent a lot of time sort of like thinking about their identity, you know, as straight white men. So, you know, there wasn't like a ton to talk about, you know, once I basically, you know, had the basics. And so I brought in very early on, like, a room full of, like, women and queer people and minorities. And, you know, I was like, okay, you know what, and, you know, they started saying, you know, talking trash about straight white men. And I said, like, okay, you know, like, what don't you like about straight white men? You know, what's your problem with them? And it was just like such an onslaught of just so many, and it was like overwhelming, like how many things they didn't like. And so I was like, okay, you know, like, we cannot genocide, you know, straight white men. Like, that's not an option. You know, like, what do you want from these people who happen to be born, you know, into this category with this label put on them? And so the students gave me a list of qualities that they wanted in straight white men. They wanted them to sit down, shut up, stay out of the way, not act like they know everything, like not take up all the opportunities, whatever. So I was like, okay. And I went home and I wrote this character who fit their dream straight white man, you know, this utopian ideal of straight white maleness. And I wrote this jerky character who embodied all of the things that they said that they hated. And I brought the characters in and we had the actors perform them. And the students, like, they hated the dream guy and they loved the jerky guy. And, you know, we talked about this afterwards, like, what happened? Like, what is that? And the thing that I realized that the play became about for me, which was just so fascinating, was that, you know, every story we're told, you know, television, movies, like books, like the fairy tales we get read as a kid, they all involve this hero's journey, right? There's a hero, they want a goal, and they're just like beating, you know, they're like defeating obstacles one by one, and then they reach the goal. Like, that is our collective model for what it means to be a worthy, a worthwhile human being of value. Like, if you can set a goal and then, like, you know, go after it, then you're worth something. And all of these things that people wanted straight white men to be, you know, were the opposite of that. You know, so that's sort of what the show became for me, just, you know, and it was made through, you know, a lot of collaboration with the cast. Like, we did a lot of improvisation, and I talked to, like, lots of people, and we brought in people to watch, and, you know, it was really a very collective process.
So I have kind of two questions that come out of that. I mean, one is, I was wondering if you could talk about, like, the length of a collaboration. So, you know, how long you live with a play. So for some people, they'll write a play and then it'll be done, or they'll do some revisions, but once it's kind of had a first production, it generally stays. That doesn't seem like the way you work at all. So I was wondering, just if you could talk about the length of that sort of process a little bit.
Right. Well, we normally, it takes maybe like 2 or 3 years to make a show, and we'll do an initial workshop and then get audiences and sort of see what the reaction is. And most of the time, it didn't happen in the case of Straight White Men so much. I'll just throw out pretty much everything and just start over from scratch. Like, that's happened a lot of times. But, you know, like, with each sort of workshop that we do, and by workshop I mean like a month of rehearsals followed by a public presentation to just sort of try it out, like, huge changes happen in between. And I've added into the process US tours, so we'll open the show somewhere in the US that's not New York, and then we'll tour it to Europe and we'll try it out there, and it will just be changing in between every performance of it. So, for example, Untitled Feminist Show, for its very first workshop, there were words in the show. Like, now there are no words, but there were words, and we practically had, like, riots break out at the workshops because people were so upset, you know, because you know, feminism is, like, a very fraught topic. And, you know, and I was just like, you know, people were so angry and they're fighting, and, like, performers were, like, yelling at people in the audience was, like, yelling back. And theatrically it was exciting, but for me, like, intellectually, that wasn't exciting. It was a bunch of people yelling at each other about how you're defining this or that. You know, little by little, I just started cutting out more and more of the words. But I think we got to a point where there were hardly any words in the show, and people would just, like, if there was one word in the show, they would just jump on it and just talk about that word, you know, with ignoring everything else that had happened. So finally we just cut out all the words, and that solved the issue, you know? Like, people still got really angry, but they couldn't really get angry about anything specific. You know, they would say, this was the best, this was my favorite criticism, this was the criticism we got the most, was like, your show isn't defining feminism or saying anything about feminism, you know? And it's because, like, we're not saying, you know, they're literally not saying anything. So that was, really, really great.
So, you know, I think a lot of us have, I don't know, really complicated relationships to the word political, but what's interesting, and this is a little bit of a segue, but the other piece that comes out of that in terms of thinking about collaboration is your dramaturgical team and how you work with dramaturgs and how you actually crowdsource dramaturgy. So I don't know if anybody in the house is friends on Facebook with Young Jean, but for those of us who are, it was actually really amazing for me to sort of be on leave and watch you dramaturging your show that you were doing at my home institution while not being in the room, and it was fascinating. But I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how you do dramaturgy work and how you crowdsource. And I think there's something incredibly political, actually, about having a dramaturgy team of people of color with white male performers on stage. And if there are any playwrights of color in the audience, you know it's often the opposite in a lot of places, meaning that you will be managed largely, often by a white director, also a white dramaturg, in which you're being translated. So I was wondering if you could talk about that reversal a little bit, and about how you actually sort of crowdsource dramaturgy.
You know, one of the sort of ideas that we have in our culture that is really harmful, I think, for artists, is the idea of the solitary genius. You know, like the genius artist who's just alone in their room and they're like coming up with these amazing things that are being channeled straight from, you know, this divine creative source, and, you know, they're just making all of this stuff and then they present it to the world. I mean, I feel like there are people who work like that, but they're very, I mean, I've never heard of one. You know, like when you start doing historical research, everybody had people that they were, even the most solitary writers who supposedly never talk to anyone, you'll find that they have this incredible like letter correspondence. You know, they just wrote tons and tons of letters to people and, you know, had this incredible support network. And, you know, I think if you want to be an artist, you know, you should absolutely take, you know, advantage of every resource that is at your disposal. You know, like if you have, you know, 100 Facebook friends, that's like 100 people that you can ask questions to, you know? And I, you know, the way that I work, when I'm directing in a room, like if, you know, somebody comes in to sweep the floor and he notices something, I mean, I can't remember the specific thing, but in that scene that you guys saw, I remember there was somebody random who just happened to be in the room and we were trying to solve a problem. And they said, oh, what about this? And, you know, and that happens all the time, you know? So I think, like, it's really, I think, you know, as an artist, like, I come very much from the point of, from the position of thinking, like, I am so limited, you know, like, my experience of the world, what I understand is just, it's like this, you know, like, I don't know what it's like to have siblings, you know, I don't know what it's like to go to prom, you know, like, I don't know what it's like to be black or white or, you know, a man, and, you know, and if I'm gonna, like, write what I know and be a genius alone in my room, you know, my work is really not gonna be that interesting, and it's gonna be very small and very limited, and for me, you know, I really feel like, I want it to be as big as possible and to sort of like learn as much as possible. And, you know, and it's like, I think a lot of artists get scared by what they don't know. You know, like I, you know, I was working on a project recently, it's a film, and I suddenly realized that I thought to myself, like, how does a person learn to become a really good, like, stalker and killer of other people? And, you know, I had no idea, so I just posted on Facebook, and a few people were like, don't post on Facebook if you want to learn how to be a stalker and killer, you know, like. But, you know, I think that's how I sort of approach everything. Like, I want to know, I mean, it would be my dream to sort of, like, be in a room with this many people and just, like, be working on my, you know, and bring in all my questions and, you know, and just say, like, you know, does anybody know somebody who's killed someone? And, like, what was the story? You know, like, just sort of getting information from people.
And I think, too, it's just acknowledging, you said a lot of people are scared. I think a lot of people couldn't run a room in which they gave up authority or were that collaborative. Like, I think they would actually find it incredibly threatening. So that may or may not have to do with being an only child or of a certain gender or ethnicity, but I would just acknowledge that some artists would not be able to run that room well, actually. So since you brought it up, I
would actually disagree with that.
Really?
Yeah, I think that... I mean, yes, you're right. If you are feeling like insecure and scared and like protective of your ego,
right,
I think it will not go well. But if you can find a way to just like let go of that and be like, oh, I'm in a room full of people and we're trying to like solve these questions, right, then there's not really a lot to run. You're just like, hey guys, like, you know, I have this problem, how do we solve it? Somebody raises their hand, you write it down. Somebody else says something, you write it down. You know, it's not, you know, there's not a lot to manage.
Right, I think you've worked with cooler artists than some other people have. And I will remain silent there. So since you brought up this moment with Untitled Feminist Show and thinking a little bit about that really early exchange about the show as you were developing it, I actually wondered, and you probably would hate this question, but how would you define feminism? Be as broad or different as you want to be. And the reason I ask is because when you talked about going from a texted show to a not texted show, that's really interesting in terms of sort of the legacy, I think, of feminist performance art, which often, sometimes has had text, but often has been embodied work without text that has used nudity very strategically. And I know that's the case with this show too. So I was wondering if you'd talk a little bit about that legacy and how it affected you or not, or how it developed.
When I first started working on the show with the cast, we talked a lot about feminism, like what is feminism? We really spent months and months, you know, talking about everything, like figuring it out. And, you know, it all went into the written version of the show that caused such a ruckus. And I guess what we came up with was that, you know, for us, I guess, you know, I don't think we ever came up with any one definition of it, but we knew that what we all wanted and what we responded to was a desire for a world where gender can be a fluid thing, you know, where you don't have to always identify as one thing and have, you know, characteristics attributed to you that are, you know, fixed. You know, as opposed to just sort of being able to be whatever and however you want from moment to moment, which is actually how we do experience the world. I mean, one of the things that was really interesting to me was, you know, all the stereotypes about straight white men or about men in general that, you know, they can't communicate, they can't express their feelings, like they don't know what's going on, they're not connected. I mean, I talked to hundreds of these men and they were not like that. You know what I mean? Like they completely had emotions. They were completely able to express them, you know? And I've talked to men who have said about themselves, I'm not connected with my emotions and I'm not a good communicator. And then we had a conversation where they'd had a lot of emotions and shared a lot, you know? So I think we get these ideas in our head about what we're like based on these gender categories. And I think for us, you know, what this show became for us was to sort of imagine, create an imaginary world where none of that existed and you were able to just sort of be whatever you happened to be in a particular moment in terms of gender.
So in the process, did you know you were going to do the show nude at the beginning, or is that something that developed as you went along?
Yeah, I had, you know, like I was thinking a lot about, you know, I was just thinking a lot about how, you know, no matter how feminist you are, like no matter, you know, how great your politics are, you know, the way that images enter our brains and give us information. Like one of the things I've been learning recently that I'm really interested in is how our brains can actually almost take on a life of their own. So, you know, like, you know, in PTSD, like your brain can think that somebody's trying to kill you and like you tell your brain like, no, like I'm safe, you know, I'm not in danger anymore, that was in the past, like you can calm down, and your brain will be like, no. And I think that the same thing happens with, you know, like getting images from the media, and you know, and I was thinking about how women are basically brainwashed into hating their bodies and they really have to fight against that brainwashing. And I had this fantasy of seeing people with female coded bodies, and I say that because not everybody in my cast identifies as female, but they all have these bodies that are coded as female. And I had this fantasy of seeing people of, you know, different shapes and sizes and like different ethnicities and just like, you know, completely not conforming to the sort of like porn fashion ideal, and to have them have like no hairstyling, no makeup, and to just have them be like incredibly fierce and like amazing. And so to do this, the casting became really important. And so I basically ended up casting literally the biggest divas in New York who I could find. And by diva, I don't mean that in the pejorative sense. I mean that as like literally, you know, like they got the wigs and the gown and the, you know, and the amazing stage presence. And they were, I mean, this is seriously, you know, so I co-created this show. I had a choreographer who was working with me and an associate director. Three of us, all women, very dominant, very used to being in charge. And we're pretty fierce ourselves, but this cast came in and we were just no match for them whatsoever. I mean, I am not even allowed in the room anymore. Like, I ask permission for everything. I'm very grateful that they're allowing me to even watch the show tonight because they have so completely taken control of it. I mean, they are
fierce and like amazing and terrifying. And to see these people on stage just dominating the room without any kind of, you know, cosmetic assistance. I mean, it, when I watch them, I'm like, wow, you know, you can have a female-coded body and just be amazing, you know, without having to groom. So that was always part of the plan.
And I'm wondering if it's that combination of attitude and the nudity that really works. I mean, I guess I think about this because if I think about the performance art of an earlier generation, right, there was something just shocking about having, you know, the nude female body in an art space. Today, I'm not sure we would ever say that's the shock, but it seems like even in this age in which it's actually quite easy to consume images of women and women who don't necessarily conform to certain quote unquote heterosexual standards, those are quite easy to access, and yet it still works. So it seems, I'm wondering if there's a generational difference, right? It seems like the show still works. Even though it's much easier for us to see those images of women.
Oh, you know, I think the thing that makes this show, that for me makes this show a little bit different from how nudity has been used in a lot of feminist work is that these people on stage are completely, like, they're in utopia. Like, they're in a state of total joy. And I think that's the thing that makes it feel different, because they are just, really, oh God, yeah. It's just about joy, and you know, this is, it's actually the first show that I've made that, you know, is not trying to make the audience uncomfortable. You know, I remember, like, I would see these, you know, like, older generation lesbian couples in the audience of the show, and they would just be like laughing, and I was like, I've made, like, the Lion King for, you know, older lesbians, you know, like this is, or for queer people, you know, like, it's definitely, you know, it's a good time, you know, and it's not, the nudity is really not confrontational. You sort of, I mean, a lot of people forget about it after the first 5 minutes, you know, like, so it's, the nudity itself is, you know, like, that's not where the provocation is.
Right. What's really interesting, especially, we were talking a little bit in the dressing room before now about the sort of dream of putting these two shows together, presenting these two shows together, and it's actually, I think just logistically, it's never been possible for these two shows to sort of run in rep. So I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit about what it is actually like. I mean, you don't know yet because you haven't seen them in successive nights, but the real importance of seeing these two shows together. And so you might be able to tell from the title, but you might not, that Straight White Men is not only about straight white men, but there are actually no women on stage in that show. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how those two shows work together, if you conceived of them together, or did that sort of, the idea of those as sort of a team happen later?
No, the team, it's just UMS, you know, thanks to UMS, they're the first people. I mean, we used to joke about doing it, but we didn't actually think it was possible, and UMS were, you know, this was the first organization that came to us and said, you know, we can make this happen. Right. And you know, Straight White Men, I don't think I've mentioned, is my first traditional three-act play. You know, I thought for this subject matter, I should use the straight white male of theatrical genres, and you know, sort of see what the limits of that were. So, you know, so this Straight White Men is like a total like three-act traditional play. Untitled Feminist Show is like, it doesn't even have words. You know, it's completely this visual, musical, like, you know, you're listening, you're watching, like it's completely nonlinear. And it's, they couldn't be more diametrically opposed, you know? And I think, you know, it would be, I mean, I don't know if this will ever happen again, you know, to have these two shows together. And so I feel like it's this unbelievably, I mean, I feel incredibly lucky to get to experience that. And, you know, like I definitely think that if you're gonna see one, you should see the other, because the way that those two, what having those two shows in your brain at the same time will do, there's no way that's not gonna be, you know, whether you hate them or love them, like, something's gonna happen in your mind that's interesting.
And they're so stylistically different, I think, as well. So so I was wondering, and I actually don't know the answer to this question, but I know when you were doing a lot of the dramaturgy for straight white men, you, of course, went to these sort of canonical straight white men plays, Miller, And what's always kind of, I mean, with all due respect, but but what's always kind of frustrating about those plays is actually they're really good plays, and there are really amazing male characters in them, but all those authors feel this obligation to put female characters on stage and often not write the female characters nearly as well as the male characters. So I'm wondering, at any point in the process, were there female characters in the play that you cut, or did you start knowing that there weren't going to be any females on stage? Because it's an interesting choice, actually.
You know, I always, there was always this little thing in the back of my mind of like, maybe a woman will show up. You know, I think my producer probably budgeted it in. At some point, Young Jean might want a woman, and then, you know, we'll, or anybody who's not a straight white man, and we'll have to bring somebody in. I mean, I really thought seriously about it, but the problem with that is that, you know, when you've got somebody on the stage who's different, it all becomes about that person, you know, and those people's relationship to this person, and especially in a play called Straight White Men, like, I just felt like it would be a more interesting experiment for me. And also part of the thing is, you know, everybody in this room probably, like, we know what straight white men act like when they're in the presence of somebody who is not a straight white man. But, you know, not all of us know what straight white men are like not in the presence of somebody who isn't a straight white man. You know, like, what straight white men are like when they're just together, right, and nobody else is around. And that became really interesting to me.
Right, and then I think there's something else about this really interesting in terms of the set also conforming to that style. So in the revision, there was this really interesting moment in the play that no longer exists about this strawberry cream cheese that, mm-hmm, I thought was super, super brilliant. And then on Facebook, I got this ad for strawberry cream cheese like not long after in my feed, and I was like, oh, what do they know about my relationship with Young Jean Lee that they're advertising strawberry cream cheese to me? But that all aside, did you feel this need to, there's a little moment where something that might be thought of as stereotypically feminine makes its place in the set, and I'm wondering how that was decided.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to tell you about it because nobody ever notices it, and
it was so blatant. I was like, oh, my God.
Yeah, people don't notice it anymore, so I'm just going to say it. Like, there's this moment in the third act where a character finally goes into the bathroom and opens the door, and it's just, like, this pink flowery wallpaper, and it's really the only feminine thing in there. And, you know, that was a very conscious choice just because of, you know, there's a dead mother who is very present in the play without actually being present, and, yeah, we just wanted to have sort of a trace of her in there. You know, and also, you know, I just want to clarify, when I'm talking about straight white men this, straight white men that, you know, I'm just referring to the sort of, you know, and this is the tricky thing, because they are stereotypes, right? Like, when I interviewed all of these men, they were telling me things about themselves that were very personal, that actually, like, if you extrapolate, it becomes a stereotype, but it's also the truth of people's experience. You know, like that stereotype about, you know, Asian parents forcing you to play the violin, that is a stereotype, but it's also true. You know, like it's coming from somewhere, you know? And so, you know, when I talk about what I found out about straight white men, it's really, you know, like I'm not trying to say that I know what all straight white men are like now. I just know about certain patterns.
Right. And so something that's really interesting about straight white men, if you look at it in the trajectory of your career, right, if you want to classify it this way, and this is questionable, that you're taking on a different identity group, perhaps, which each play you do, something that hadn't been talked about, but I think is something that's really, a lot of people are talking about because of our economic moment, is talking about class and labor. So to my mind, actually, the beginning of me writing this essay that I wrote about straight white men was watching the show and being like, oh, I guess that's about identity, but to me, this is really also about class and labor and this particular moment in which straight white men, and especially straight white men who are not affluent, are incredibly threatened in the culture because of the economic situation that we're in. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that and how those discussions about class and debt ended up coming into the room.
Well, I mean, I actually, So Patricia wrote this after I did the first production at Brown University. Patricia wrote an essay about it that so perfectly articulated what we were trying to do in a way that like we wouldn't have been able to articulate it. And so we actually used that as a sort of guide when we were going through the rest of it. So like I couldn't say it as well as you could. Can you just tell them what the thesis of your article was?
Sure, I'll try. So basically, I make the argument that sort of this, if you want to take the character sort of unlikability, right, like all the characteristics that make him a good straight white man and the ideal dramaturgy of people of color, right?
Yeah, this is that ideal straight white man.
The straight white man who like sits down, shuts up, like doesn't act like a guy, right? And then I make this claim, right, that all of those particular actions, right, and his attempt to act like a guy sort of point to this moment that we're in terms of labor, which is like what we do is no longer what we do. It's like how we present ourselves and our jobs. I mean, it's for those of you who read Foucault, and I hope there aren't so many of you in the audience, but for those of you who do, there's a way in which it's like our presenting of ourselves as a commodity, as an attitude, is more important than like what we actually do. And so there's a scene that I won't talk about in any detail in the play in which this sort of performing of self happens. And I thought it was brilliant, but also it's like the most incredibly painful moment too. And so to my mind, this play was really, was talking about this moment of labor. And I think especially, and this might really resonate with some people in the audience, this moment of thinking about the real cost of educational debt, which I don't think we talk about enough, but there might be some people in the audience who are feeling it. So I just want to acknowledge that.
I mean, you know, I found that, I mean, this is a crazy thing to say, but like, you know, I found that people tend to divide into these two camps when it comes to the show, where it's, you know, there's a certain way of thinking, which, you know, you articulated so well in your essay, that is, it's like a long gone model of success where or having credentials where it's like, oh, okay, so I'm a bricklayer. I've been bricklaying for all these years, like I'm really good at laying bricks. And that is valuable in the marketplace, you know, like how good I am at this, how many years of experience, how fast I am, you know, this is what I can do. And now I feel like we're in this world where, you know, I could sit up here with my microphone on the stage and talk to all of you and say like, oh my God, I'm like, my bricklaying is amazing. Like I have this new way of laying bricks and I could just talk up a storm and, you know, barely know how to lay bricks at all, you know, but I could like make a living, you know, like you can, there are people who can just sell who don't have any skills or product, but they can sell, you know what I mean? Like they can sell themselves. And I mean, this is actually like, it's surreal to having this conversation while I sit up here, because what I'm doing right now, a lot of artists can't do that. You know, like a lot of artists hate the idea of having like lights in your face and this big audience and you have to like talk about your work and like make it sound interesting and like make yourself seem interesting. You know, like that's a nightmare for a lot of people, especially people who measure their, who want to be valued for their skills. And it's becoming increasingly a world where you can't just sort of, you know, be able to do your job well and get ahead.
And I think a lot of people's anxiety is that like there's nothing in the culture that's telling us, oh, this thing is happening and you're gonna feel really screwed up about it.
Yeah.
And interestingly, it's sometimes often these straight white men who, because they have been unmarked, right, haven't been the tools to understand what happens and what you're marginalized. And so in some ways, like that's sort of what makes us so sympathetic to those characters, I think, even those of us who might not be given to be super sympathetic to straight white men having, you know, a life crisis on stage in a room with a couch, you know, like.
Right. I mean, in an academic context, like the best example I can think of is, you know, like when I was an undergrad, you know, many years ago, I had these Shakespeare professors and, you know, and I would talk to them about, you know, like what was the job market like back when you, you know, graduated, when you got your PhD, and they were like, oh, well, you know, like I had studied Shakespeare as an undergrad and I had studied it as a PhD student, and so then there was a job for me. to teach Shakespeare, and that's how it worked. And you know, and today, like, if you know anything about academia, that is not how it works. You know, like, you have to be, you know, at that MLA conference giving the flashiest paper. You know, like, you have to. You even have to worry about, like, what you wear, you know? And that was, like, never, you know, an issue back in the day. Like, I mean, I wouldn't say never, but it was so much less of an issue.
No, I think it was a lot less of an issue. You spend a lot less time, I think, broadcasting yourself, actually, in some ways. And so, you know, in a kind of, well, in like a kind of theater history context, it's interesting because the first thing you think about, right, is Willie Loman, right, who's, mm-hmm. like, being sourced out of his form of labor. And that's right. exactly kind of... sort of what happens here in some ways as he's kind of changing that. So I think that was kind of amazing, actually, to think of those things together. I think what I'd like to think about a little bit now, because we're at a really interesting moment, I think about thinking about diversity in the arts and diversity in the theater as a whole. And so for those of you, I don't know, who have not been online at all or read the newspaper, maybe that isn't so true, but there have been a number of casting controversies. So we're at this moment of really trying to think about what diversity in the professional theater is, but which bodies get to play which roles and at which time, and there are really different opinions about that. So I'm wondering how you're thinking about this moment in terms of diversity in the American theater. And how, because you've been doing this kind of work for a really long time and confronting these issues with a lot of humor, which people don't always confront these issues with a lot of humor. So I wonder if you could just talk about this moment.
You know, I've started teaching a workshop, and this is not a joke. It's an actual workshop, and it's called How to Collaborate Outside of Your Culture Without Being a Total Dick. And, you know, it's been very popular, and you know, and I think, you know, there are a lot of different ways to do it, but I think, you know, people are very afraid to do this because they're afraid they're going to get in trouble or, you know, somebody's going to call them a racist or, you know, and then they shy away from it, and then people call them a racist for, you know, for not doing it. So it's like, you know, I guess the best example I can give is I made a show in 2009, I think, called The Shipment, and I wanted to do a show that explored Black identity, you know, which is... you know, like, obviously I say that, you know, and, you know, you can immediately see, like, a million ways that I could get into trouble. And the way that I worked on the show was I, you know, got together a cast, and they were, everyone was Black, and I basically got them into a room, and I said, you know, what kind of show would you want to be in, and what would you want it to be about? And that was basically it. You know, there was no drama. There was no, I mean, there. You know, I made a few faux pas. Like, at a certain point, I remember, like, we were trying to find a song for them to sing, and somebody jokingly mentioned the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing. And so they sang it for me, and I was like, oh my God, like, I love that song. We have to put it in the show. And they were like, are you crazy? That song is sacred. Like, if my grandmother came to see this show with all the profanity and craziness that's happening, and we sang that sacred song, we would get in so much trouble. So, you know, I got shut down. But, you know, in terms of the collaboration, it was actually, like, very easy, you know? Like, and I think what makes people afraid to collaborate is because they don't ever want to, I don't know, like, there's such a protectiveness of you know, I want to do, like, my thing, you know? And, but if... I don't know exactly how to describe it, but, like, I don't know why that would be hard for anybody to just say, hey, I'm interested in doing this thing that I don't know anything about. You know, like, are you interested, you know, in having me, you know, make this thing for you to perform in, like a personal chef? You know, that's sort of how I thought about it. And I said, like, from day one, I said, you know, you have veto power over anything that happens in this show. So if you ever find yourself in a position where you're on stage doing something that you don't feel good about, like, that's on you because you never said anything. You know, so everybody just would speak up whenever there was something that was a problem. And the thing that's great about vetoing is, you know, you can always come up with something better. There is no such thing as an idea that is so amazing that you can't come up with, you know, a better alternative. So, You know, I just feel like, I think there are other ways to collaborate other than how I did it, but you know, for me, it's never this kind of like walking on eggshells, like, is somebody gonna yell at me? Is somebody calling me racist? You know, if you're just like super open and you're not trying to, you know, impose your ideology on somebody else.
And I'm wondering too, does it feel like a different moment? Like, I'm very indecisive about this moment and whether it feels different or it just has felt the same for the last 10 or 15 years.
Oh my gosh, it's so different. Like, somebody can tweet something racist and a bunch of other people can tweet and they can get fired. Like, that is unprecedented, you know? Like, that is very new. Like, that's something that's just happening. Now, and you know, like, I heard about, I heard a story about some, you know, straight white male novelist who was on a panel, and he said something to, you know, an African American woman who was on the panel, that said something like, "You don't know anything about being black," and it ruined his career, you know. So it's like, I totally think this is a different moment, in, you know, as far as that kind of stuff is concerned.
Right. And does it?
And by the way, that story, I just heard it from somebody else like a few weeks ago, and I'm probably totally misremembering all the details of it. So if you try to Google who that was, like, you might, you know, it might, it probably won't be the person I'm talking about.
And I'm just wondering too, I'm just thinking a little bit, having seen the really early work you did and then seeing work that's come later, does it feel different in the theater? I mean, I just feel like you've been doing some of this work, and so I guess, to my mind, like, the moment that you come out of, if we want to think of the New York avant-garde theater as sort of the hub or the sort of lab for a lot of the work you did, the moment, like, that early moment was, like, very steeped in a very particular kind of irony, I think. And now it seems like maybe we're not in that moment so much, and so I'm wondering if you feel that in your work, too. Do you feel yourself being less ironic?
Yeah, but I think that's just because I'm getting old. You know, like, I, you know, it's you know, just, like, the older you get, like, bad stuff starts happening to you. Like, your parents die, and, like, people get sick, and, like, you know, it's just, you start to develop a lot more sort of empathy for the world, and you're much less snotty about things, and, you know, so I don't know if, for me, that's, like, a cultural thing, but, you know, but I'd be interested in sort of, like, diving back into that.
And so I guess I'm just being very mindful of time, giving everything everyone has to do. I'm wondering, and you totally don't know I'm going to ask you this, so I'm just going to preface that. I'm wondering, because there are so many young artists in the room, if you, I don't know if it's advice really that I'm asking, but if you have words of wisdom about making a career. You've moved through a lot of genres, you started doing one thing, and you've moved to becoming a performer. And so I'm wondering if you just have a bit of advice about how to navigate that. You went from not having a lot of resources to now having a lot of resources, and I guess that's, I won't say, that's what happens to a lot of mid-career artists. I wonder if you could
talk about what happens to a lot of mid-career artists?
I mean, it doesn't happen to everybody, but sometimes you start off with not a lot of resources, and if you're lucky, you end up with more resources, right? And that sometimes changes the work and sometimes doesn't. And so I just wonder if you have any advice about starting in some ways and sort of making your way through that trajectory as an artist, as if you're lucky, you do actually have more access to resources.
I mean, like, my biggest advice, just coming from my own experience with becoming an artist, which I did late, I didn't start until I was 29, I guess my biggest advice would just be find your people, you know, find a community. And it could be, you know, your cousin who you write letters to, or, you know, but it's just like the more people you have who understand what you're trying to do and are supportive of it, and they'll, like, look at things and give you feedback and you trust them. I mean, that to me is, you know, that was the first thing that I looked for when I came to New York to, you know, try to break into theater. It was just looking for, you know, it's not about, it's not about trying to, like, get the attention of some famous person, and, you know, I mean, people talk about schmoozing and networking and how much they hate all of that, and, you know, I don't really think that's the mentality you should go out with. It was like, oh, I gotta make connections. You know, like I've seen people at film festivals actually where they're you know, professionally amazing at that. They're like, oh my God, this person can help me. Hello, you know? But I'm talking about something different. Like I'm talking about people who can really support and nurture you as an artist. You know, and that person isn't necessarily gonna be the person who's closest to you. You know, like that, it just, and it has to be somebody who believes in you. And the more of those people you have, the better of a chance of success, I think you have. Like, but if you're you know, just sitting alone in your room, struggling to come up with something, you know, like that's, you know, that the next, you know, the best thing you can do is just go out and try to find somebody. And it can be, you know, my first theater connection ever happened when I was living in New Haven. I knew that there was like a Yale School of Drama there, and so I read a play by each of the playwrights who was on faculty, and there was one play that I liked the best, and so I wrote an email to the playwright and said, hey, you know, this is who I am, and I read a play by, you know, all of the faculty members of Yale School of Drama, and I liked your play the best, and I'm wondering if you would meet with me. And the person said yes. And I will tell you now, like, in school, they may teach you, like, reach out to people and ask them if they'll have coffee with you. It's much more appealing to have coffee with somebody who, like, selected you in that particular way than just randomly, some people will, but, you know, like, give people a reason to want to meet with you. And he met with me, and he gave me a list of names, and I went out, I moved to New York, and I found those people, and, you know, and they became my community. So that's how I did it. That's, like, one way to do it.
Great. Thank you so much for such a wonderful conversation, and I would just like to thank you and have the audience thank you.